Tonight's story is somewhat unique and calls for a different kind of introduction.
Some legal news in California. Michael Jackson is still inside a California courtroom at this hour.
The arrival of Michael Jackson, who didn't have to be here, along with his parents and five siblings, all of whom, like Michael, were dressed in white today. That was what the fans came to see.
Dressed in white, symbolic of his proclaimed innocence, Michael Jackson flashed a peace sign to dozens of cheering fans. The King of Pop, though not required to be here, wanted to hear testimony from Santa Barbara District Attorney Tom Sneddon. In an unusual twist, the prosecutor took the witness stand to give details of a search he conducted at a private investigator's office in Beverly Hills. The investigator was working for Jackson's former attorney, Mark Garagos, at the time. That's a violation of attorney-client privilege, according to Jackson's current lawyer. He says evidence obtained by Sneddon and the Santa Barbara County Sheriff's Department is inadmissible. County officials say they didn't know the private investigator was working for Garagos.
A key exchange just happened. Jackson's lead attorney, Tom Mesereau, asking Sneddon in a conference call back on July 8th, when you and your entire prosecution team were talking to the entire defense team, did you or did you not say that you knew that Bradley Miller, the investigator, worked for Mark Garagos, a lawyer? Sneddon's answer, yes. Did any of the other three prosecutors who were with you qualify or interject or interrupt or contradict what you'd said? The answer, no. Sneddon then said that the next day he woke up, realized it was a big mistake, and in fact had spent the entire morning today insisting that neither he nor anyone on his team had any inkling at all that Bradley Miller, the investigator, worked for the lawyers.
The 45-year-old singer has accused Sneddon of waging a personal vendetta against him since allegations of child sex abuse first surfaced back in 1993.
Sneddon denies the vendetta accusations and feels his team has a strong case.
I now pronounce you man and wife.
Thank you.
Michael?
Your babies are sleeping like angels. You're doing me real proud, son. Well, I'm happy that you're happy, Mother.
You're a real family man now?
Yep.
Harris, Prince,
this is Mr. Bashir. Say hi to Mr. Bashir.
Hello.
Mr. He's doing Bashir. A movie about Daddy. Why can't you share your bed? The most loving thing you could do is share your bed with someone.
It was becoming clear to me that Michael Jackson had an obsession with children.
Turn that off!
It all began with a chance meeting in 1992. Jackson's car broke down in Los Angeles and he showed up at a rental car agency. The owner's stepson, a huge Jackson fan, got to meet his idol. Rizzo is a Chicago private eye who met with the boy's father and had access to some of the early evidence in 1993. Norma Salinas worked for the boy's father and stepmother. She says the boy's father and stepmother acted as though there was nothing unusual about the visit, except when they instructed Salinas to keep the drapes pulled shut during the entire weekend Jackson was visiting. It was in this Spartan room, a room without a TV set, Salinas says, that Michael Jackson and the 13-year-old boy spent virtually an entire weekend, and all with the father's full knowledge and consent. Jim Thomas was the sheriff in Santa Barbara County. He's now an NBC News consultant.
We always believed there were 8 to 10 other children out there. Many of them said that they had spent time with Michael Jackson. They had spent time in his bedroom, but that nothing had happened. Some wouldn't talk to us at all. Of everyone that was talked to, two said yes.
Even though the primary victim in the 1993 case dropped out and stopped cooperating, you couldn't go forward with the other victim because what he was alleging was not enough of a crime?
No, he wouldn't do it if the other one didn't. He was ashamed. He was afraid that people would question his sexual orientation.
You know, we should say that Michael Jackson last week released a statement to Dateline NBC in response to its report on the 1993 molestation case and to the $2 million payout to a second accuser. Here's a proportion of that statement. I'm going to have to read it. It's called, "It is unfortunate that yet again I must respond to untruth and journalism. Years ago, I settled with certain individuals because I was concerned about my family and the media scrutiny that would have ensued if I had fought the matter in court. These people wanted to exploit my concern for children by threatening to destroy what I believe in and what I do. I have been a vulnerable target for those who want money." And the question is, why now?
In 2003, I saw Michael Jackson on TV in a documentary. There was this little boy with his head against Michael's shoulder holding hands, and Michael talking about how, you know, it's okay to sleep in bed with little boys. And that just gave me the chills because it brought everything back up. And I thought, you know, parents...
Do you want to stop this from happening again?
Absolutely.
If these kids were really molested, why didn't Tom Sneddon prosecute Michael Jackson for those three kids?